Good morning, everybody. It's a Sunday morning. It's very pretty. Well, not as pretty as I like it, but a little cloudy. But it's a nice day. I got my little study. Is like a chapel for me. And when I get up in the morning and I'm praying, I light candles in here. And I got incense. And then I pray in the yard, and this is almost like I take some of the guys to, there's a church here in Corpus Christi, not the one I'll be going to, I think, this morning. Either I'll go to the cathedral or Bay Area Church in Limited, but there's another one, Mother Teresa's, and it serves the homeless. That's the Catholic church that does a lot of homeless outreach. And I used to take Pops there to get bread and stuff, and Pops likes a little chapel there. But a few times I've taken some of the other guys, Jimmy and them, for different stuff. And just when you walk into the property, because it's dedicated to God, you can feel God's presence. And it's like a prayer garden. And that's what this is here for me. This is like I got my pond pump, and I'm up here in the morning. I try to see, I got these little steps here that I built. Okay, they remind me of the scriptures. I'll stand in this corner, and there's a verse. It says, "The Lord carried me away in the spirit into a great and high mountain." And then I wrote on the side of this a verse from Hebrews, "For he looked for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God." And I tried to, this prayer experience when I'm here, is I try to see the work of God, whether it's me communicating through teaching you guys, man, I almost dropped this phone in the water, or whether it's working with the people you see me work with. I try to see that God has committed somewhat a responsibility to communicate to that community. And some of the verses I quote when I stand right here is, "My house is a house of prayer for all nations." And I pray, I say, and there's a scripture I quote, that in this mountain, the veil and the covering that is on the face of all people shall be removed. And then I speak to the princes of Abraham, speak into Islam, into Judaism, and into the church. And I say, God, may the truth of God go forth. And a few years back when we had the so-called Arab Spring, and I was teaching somewhat from Exodus about Egypt. I'll never forget, I was quoting some verses that just had to do with my prayer time and my reading, and it talked about like Pharaoh. Pharaoh would represent, the bad Pharaoh would represent unjust leadership, unjust government. I'll never forget, I was praying, you know, pull down Pharaoh, pull down the leader of Egypt, just as a sort of not particularly talking about Egypt. And right at that time, when I was doing the study, the leader of Egypt came down. Hosni Mubarak, who was, you know, King Pharaoh for maybe 30 years in Egypt, and then you had the toppling of Mubarak. And I had some Muslim readers, or Arab readers at the time, because I saw on the blog, I thought, oh, isn't that interesting? I wanted to share a few things. This I don't know, it could be a teaching video. Each time I wrap up, I have one video before this one that's already made that I'm trying to put verses and stuff on. And I really feel at times that ministries and teaching and all that we do are for a season. I like the example of Pope Benedict, because he really shook up the Catholic world when he simply said, it's time for me to step down, which was rare. Okay, it's happened before, but, you know, it's very rare for a pope to not finish out, you know, until he either passes away or gets very sick. But Benedict, he was struggling with health in the sense of he was a little tired and all. But it was a surprise, because I cut out his little last prayer. I got it in my journal. at the time that that happened. And he said something like, now I'm going to go away, and I hope to continue to serve the church and humanity. God bless everybody. And that was it. That was it. And there were other people that have done that before. And I thought, I don't know if we really have teachers, preachers. Ministry becomes an addictive thing at times. The sense that, and Jeremiah the prophet, at one point in his ministry, he said, that's it, I'm done. I'm done, I'm going away. And it said the word was in him like a fire in his bones. And he felt like he had to communicate because that was what God was saying at that time. So I would just say in general, I think we don't, as leadership, pastors, ministers, I think sometimes we don't always leave that as a possibility. But it's hard to do that. And I've done that in different periods of time. And I went through some stages where I said, I'm going to really, you know, get away from the scene and just let everything that we've done already, the teaching and all that's on there. When I first started that website, these different websites, I'm very illiterate or whatever when it comes to, I didn't know how to make links, I didn't know how to upload videos, I didn't know nothing. I was very, very behind. Many of you watching all these, as you can tell, but you knew how to, you know, make links and all, and I was very late to the game. You know, I didn't have email, and I don't really ever check my email. Google's got a system where it's, yo, once you got on the Google Plus or whatever. But I remember I was in New Jersey, North Bergen, on that trip I made a few years back. And the first video, I think I posted that first video the other day with me and Nick. Nick playing the guitar there right by Hudson County Park. But I had such a struggle when I didn't know how to make video and put it onto the computer. And then I had to take the chip out, you know, from the phone or whatever they call it. And it was a struggle. And I remember I was in North Bergen and I was in the middle of like, oh, I'm going to start all over and I got to find where I could live. And I thought, oh, but I'm going to have to go out and run into street guys. Or I ain't going to make it. I just won't make it. And that's how I met those guys. And one day Nick said, John, can you give me a ride to the music place? I remember, I think I went to that one as a kid. I forget which road it was on. It's one of the music stores in that area. He wanted to get a guitar. He bought a little guitar that day. But man, it was raining. The car was not running good. And I was in the midst of shambles. Yeah. And I thought, I'm going to just do what I can. And I made efforts, but it was very hard for me to learn how to do websites. Very hard for me to learn how to do that. And I tried to give people, multiple times when I got back to Texas, I said, look, I just need somebody to help me I'll pay somebody if I can. I could not find anybody. I went and someone said, go to the college, the university here, A&M University, which you have an extension here, right? Over there, it's the Island University. I went one day, I said, look, someone recommended maybe the computer course here, the people here. I couldn't find anybody, and I thought at that time, I said, God, are you telling me I have to learn how to do it? You know, they say if you need something done, you got to do it. And I thought, I just can't. And there are actual functions I do now when I'm copying the link from WordPress and when I do those functions, I kid you not, I think, how did I know how to do that? There were certain functions when you're making the links from the different sites and even till this day, when I'm doing it, I think, I don't remember learning how to do that. And so God will give you grace. I have some scriptures here that I think these came from Pops, some of these verses. Just when I first met Pops, and a few times he'd open up his Bible, and I'd remember, oh, that chapter. I forget what chapters these are from. Take heed now, for the Lord has chosen you to build a house for the ark. Be strong and do it. I got that verse when I started working with Pops. I was reading some of the scriptures about God giving Moses. There were two men. I forget their names, but they had certain gifts of wisdom to help Moses when he was building the ark and the tabernacle. And so God was telling me, I felt, build all things, this is a verse, according to the pattern that I showed you on the mount. And my experience when I was in the Northeast that time, New Jersey, was I was on the mount. And God says, okay, when you get back to Texas, follow that pattern. And I'm just communicating this. I felt once we got so much of the teachings on these various websites and YouTube and all the links, I felt like pretty much most of it is done. I think I've communicated for the most part. There are still important things that I can teach, and maybe I'll teach Galatians one day, but I felt the majority of the work is now, done. And so then sometimes I think maybe it would be good to, do a Pope Benedict thing. But it's difficult to do that. It's difficult to say, that's it. I've finished what I'm going to do. I've debated with that more than once, many times. I'd just like to get away and just finish the course. I swear I think that a lot. So we got to see. I wanted to mention, I wanted to say something and call it maybe in defense of the cops. Because this week, the trial for the Freddie Gray murder in Baltimore, they had those cops, I guess it was five of them, that it's famous, been in the media, and they began trying those officers separately. And the first one, I forget if his name is Porter or something, but he's a black cop, and what that cop did was he drove that van that Freddie Gray died in, and there was neglect in the sense that they didn't seatbelt Freddie Gray in the van, and Freddie Gray was asking for medical attention. But what they're trying him for, this was not like a shooting where some of the other videos you've seen and cover up, and this was kind of more of a neglect thing. And they had a hung jury at the time of me speaking, and December of 2015, and because it was a hung jury, the prosecutor had to decide whether or not they would retry him. They already decided they're going to retry him. There's a lot of problems with our system. Understand something. A lot of it is really not biblical or just in this sense. When you have these cases, death penalty cases, where different cases where you need a majority or you need a unanimous decision, and maybe if it's 11 out of the 12 jurors or how many, and if there's one holdout, oftentimes judges will say, there's one holdout, go back. We're going to keep here, go back until you can come to a decision. Go back until... It's quite obvious all you're telling them at that point, if it's going on for days in some cases, this did not. But all you're saying is you're not leaving until you decide you're going to vote the way with everybody else. Look, that has nothing to do with justice when you're doing that, when you're pressuring the juror to say, well, go back. That's not justice. If you have looked at all of the evidence in an honest and clear conscience, and you have some on the jury that say guilty, some who say innocent, you say, well, you're not leaving until, after a week, he was tried by his peers. That is totally unjust to do that. But in this case, you had a hung jury, and the judge got some criticism because he allowed it. He quickly dismissed it and said it's hung. But I want to say, in defense of that cop, what they're trying him for the various things, it wasn't, this is more of a neglect thing that this officer did. He didn't put the seatbelt on him, and I'm familiar with some of these laws because of the EMT and fire department. And I would just be careful that you're not making an example. It's never right to take either a citizen, a civilian, or an officer and say, we're going to now make an example out of you. And so I'm just leery. If they had a hung jury in that officer's case, and he happens to be a black officer, by the way, I just think this is, you're looking at a different level of crime than like an open shooting in somebody and covering up the shooting and all that other stuff. Now, this case in Chicago, where now they're calling for Mayor Rahm Emanuel to step down, they're justified in that because the black teen who was shot there and killed, they were not moving on that. They had all the evidence, video and everything, and they were just going to let that until there was a open records freedom request that's some organization made, then they knew the video of that shooting would get out, and hours before the release of the video, they then put charges on that officer. That's in the Chicago case. So there you could see they were openly covering up there and lying and all. And Rahm Emanuel says he never saw the video, but they settled with that family for like $5 million. It seems as if he needs to go, Rahm Emanuel, because, you know, it's crime when you lie to the government. FBI investigation, all these little things going on, or big things, and the did you know about the connections to this ISIS when they question people? It should be a crime for a mayor or a police department to also lie, cover up, and then when it's found out later, wait a minute, you lied about the murder of my child. And you say, well, it wasn't a crime, it wasn't a grand jury thing. They should be, you know, we should look at some of that. So I wanted to mention that because I thought it was good to mention. If I went to the Mass already, I would have maybe quoted some of the scriptures. But I didn't go, so there's not a particular thing. I wanted to also just mention quick on the... You heard me talk about the Social Security situation with some of my homeless friends. What upsets me sometimes on that, every time, is the guys that do disability and are drug addicts and they're not disabled, and so many of them are in better shape than me. That's wrong. That's wrong. But you have people that are actually the age of retirement. We're not talking disability. And they have something that they have some years that they actually work. And when I began to see that the Social Security system also would prefer for those people to not get it, that upsets me, that they made it difficult. I had more than one instance where I had a homeless friend who actually was over 62, homeless. And it's not, you just go in and apply and say, I'm here at this, oh. And I remember when my friend Andy, who's just simply getting it because of his age, it's not a, and they were saying, oh, he didn't do this right, he had to go to this meeting or whatever it was. I kept saying, this is not disability. You're purposefully putting all types of loopholes that people have to jump through that are actually not asking for. They're just asking for regular, the time they worked throughout their life, whatever amount it was. Many of them have, my friends. And you're making it hard for them. And there's no concern on your behalf to, if they didn't show up and they missed it and they can't get a hold of it. It's a disgrace that they do that. It's a disgrace. And I would say in general, economically, financially, this country and the global economy is not good. And they would prefer for the average person to not really see it that way. And I'm persuaded that sometimes they do these things because they know there's difficulty. And as much as they can to not give money out, even in legitimate cases, people that work for it. That's a shame. It's also a shame that they don't look at the history of people. In my case, I put a lot of money into it because I worked for over 25 years. I worked even a few years before I became a firefighter. But I put a lot into a lot because it was a consistent thing. And I think, you know, they don't look at that. They don't care about any of that. in some cases, they might think, oh, this guy actually qualifies for more than an average. It's a shame. So, I want to bless you guys today. This is just a quick thing. Oh, should I teach a little? That way, maybe it'll be a teaching video. I'm covering the history of the church. And I'm trying to do world history, philosophy. You guys know my stuff. And a lot of times, we kind of distinguish. This is studying church history, or theology, or philosophy, or physics, or science. But it's all together. You can't, really can't. So, you heard me talk about the son of Isabella and Ferdinand, the king and queen of Spain, right at the time of the late 1400s into the 1500s, which is the big time of the Reformation right there. And I mentioned the other day King Henry VIII's wives. So, Prince Charles V, which was the son of Isabella and Ferdinand, eventually you have Christopher Columbus, 1492, Viceroy of the seas, oceans. And this, most of us familiar with this, is that they were looking for the route, what they thought was the West Indies, and the discovery of America. And Columbus sails the seas, and not realizing it's America, but it's Latin America, and the first place he hits, he called, they were going to just claim territory, colonizations. And San Salvador, which means Holy Savior. And so that's, okay, we're going to start claiming it. Now, Prince Charles V, not only was the King of Spain at that point, but the Holy Roman Emperor as well. You heard me talk about it. And so this is showing you how now Christian history and world history are all the same. Because when you study the Reformation, the Protestant Reformation, Martin Luther out of Germany, during that whole study, at one point Luther appears at what's called, it's a meeting with the Catholic Church officials, whether they're going to, you know, condemn him finally as a heretic or whether he will recant. It's a quite famous meeting. It's called the Diet of Worms, okay, Worms, but it's spelled W-O-R-M-S, and it's just Diet of Worms, but it's a meeting. It's, and he appears for the church, and the emperor, Holy Roman Emperor, which is King of Spain, Charles V, and he makes some famous comments, Luther, but it just shows you that at the time that Luther was called before the council, before the assembly like that, at the same time, Columbus was beginning these explorations, and you could, and some refer to the next 150 years from about 1500 to 1650 as also an age of discovery, because the European, not only were they beginning to come to Mexico and Latin America, all the way from the tip of South America, kind of all the way right to California, began to be colonized. And then you had what's called the conquistadors, which were supposedly, you know, they were coming over, and there was a mix of whether there was sincere missionary efforts or evangelization by force. And the name, that's where we get I could say it normally, and I can't right now. Conquistadors. And then you had the fall of the great Aztec people, which was a sad history of how, which now today we're much familiar with. But it's just interesting to notice that they began trading posts, outposts, not only in Latin America, but also along the Asian, along the African coast, and you have the Portugal traders as well. And the story, if you remember, with Robert De Niro, it's a good movie called The Mission. You could see it in that. And some of the missionaries, and these were all Catholic. You had the Jesuits, the Dominicans, the Franciscans, various Catholic missionaries that began establishing their understanding of the church in these areas. And some, one of the, I think his name was De La Casas, who converted, became a priest. De La Casas, part of the colonization, he saw it. His father was on the second voyage of Christopher Columbus, but he began seeing the mistreatment of the Indians, and he began standing up for the Indians. And so he was a Catholic priest who was noted for his defense of the Indians and what was going on, with which today we understand in the history of what happened to the Native American or the American Indian was wrong, and a lot of wrong was done. So even at that stage, you had some sincere Catholic missionaries and priests who began standing up for the rights of the Indian. And there was a debate on how, you know, I mentioned this before, some call it syncretism, but when you're going into other cultures and you're wanting to evangelize, should you try to make them change their whole culture to embrace Christianity? Of course not. But efforts like that were made. There was a misunderstanding in some of these missionary movements where what they were saying was, you know, trying to make them embrace the whole culture of the European understanding of the church, whether it was Catholics going over or Protestants that were missionaries as well. So I figured I'd throw some of that in. That's a little church history. Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel, the good news to every creature. And our effort, in the beginning of the video I was saying, if we can, in our lifetime, as best as possible, to communicate the truth, that's what counts. That's what counts. And it's not so much that you're building a big financial organization, nor is it so much that you're building a lot of physical things. Those things can be used. Some of the great universities you hear me speak about are actual, you know, universities. But you're primarily building a city. You're communicating to a people. Whatever means God gives you to spread, this is for leadership, whatever means you have to spread the truth, to spread the message, that's what you're doing. And in the New Testament, when the Apostle Paul was building what we say the church, or the churches, and he says he had all the care of all the churches upon him at one point. He was not talking about all of the understanding that we have today, you know, the upkeep of the building and the taxes. He was simply talking about those communities of believers that he communicated the gospel to in the various places we read about in the New Testament. And so when he taught them Christ, spent time with them, Ephesus, Galatians, Corinth, all these things, letters we read in the New Testament, those communities were simple communities of people understanding God, coming to belief in Christ, seeing him as the answer. And so this was not a lot of overhead to do that. It was simply whatever means to communicate. And Paul was writing those letters we have today in the New Testament canon. And then he was also going, it says, from house to house. And publicly, he would also follow the pattern of Jesus, speaking in the synagogues. The book of Acts is the Areopagus. He would speak in the areas where people were known to come to hear philosophers. Wherever, whatever means to communicate to the people, that was the main thing. And it wasn't building. Paul was not going around. In today's mindset, you would see, like, maybe Paul, people would think he was going around saying, God has called me to this apostolic calling, and if you fund my apostolic calling, God will bless you, because you guys can't do it, but God will bless you just for supporting me. Now, Paul says things in the Philippian letter that they're going to get a reward because they did help support Paul. But the primary way I think we miss it in today's understanding of what it means to be in ministry, what it means to be church, is once you deposit that truth into the people, and they're converted, and they become members of the family of God, that's the thing of value. That's the city coming down from God out of heaven. And if it's a silly thing like a free YouTube channel or a blog, the only thing I pay for is the WordPress site. I don't have to, but in order to have the videos where people could download them for free and have them, whereas YouTube you can just watch, but if you're not online, you can't see the YouTube videos. So there's places where people might be able to get online at one point, and then they're not online later on. Online access, so that way I pay for that little that side. It's not a whole lot, but I do pay for space there. But the point I'm making is we just want to get to communicate the truth to as many people as possible. And thank God we live in a day where we don't have to do like the Apostle Paul, where the letters would be written and then they'd be circulated. We live in a day where we can communicate it and do not see the means of the communication, whether it's like expensive media programs, do not see that as the people are there primarily to fund that. That's another mistake I think that's made. The value is the people that are being communicated to. And those people can run with the message. I'm reading Proverbs, I read it every night along with the other scriptures. But it says wisdom is so valuable, greater than all the other things you can. I've got a verse here. Wisdom has built the house. Understanding establishes it. And through knowledge, its chambers are filled with all pleasant and precious riches. So wisdom gives you the capability and the ability to impact people groups. And please understand, in the New Testament, there was not this rush that there's a lot of money needed to do this. It's very simple. I shared that story with you about the woman who broke the alabaster box of ointment upon Jesus. And if you read all the Gospels together and read that story, that's the point where Judas decides to go out and betray him later. At that point, because Judas was stealing money from the treasury, the bag that he held. And some people used to teach, the ones who focus on money a lot would say, obviously there was a lot of money in that bag because they didn't know money was being taken out. But it says, it was primarily for the poor. That the collection there was primarily for the poor. But it met the simple needs of Jesus and his men. And so when you go into the New Testament, you see the same thing. The apostles, wherever they go into a city or a place, Jesus said in the gospel, the laborer is worthy of his hire. He said, therefore, wherever city or place you enter into, whoever puts you up for the night, whoever feeds you, eat what's given to you, let them help you. See, they weren't, he was giving them, when he said the laborer is worthy of his hire, he's just simply saying, when you're in a certain area communicating the gospel, you're going to live with those people as a community. That's all he was saying. And we turned that into, like, we're going to inherit all this. A book was written on it, Inheriting the Abrahamic Wealth, how each believer is going to become millionaires. It was taught, it's still taught. But we're missing the simple message. And Judas himself was mad because the money was wasted upon Jesus, in the sense that the woman poured the perfume. And he sought opportunity after that to betray him, because that was a covetous heart. He thought, geez, I'm in this thing to get something out of it. And if Jesus is not going to do a whole overthrow, then we might as well get some money out of it. Covetousness. So what I want you to see is let God simply use you to build people, to communicate truth. And if you have just enough to get you to the place to communicate it, that's all that's really required. Or if you have these simple tools that you see me use, somebody that didn't know how to do any of this. Many of you watching these videos know how to do more than I knew when I first started. And it's valuable not because, I got something on YouTube. Or, no, it's valuable because if you're communicating truth and it's going forth, that's the power of the gospel. Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. And so utilize that. Utilize these things. Okay, I want to bless you guys. I just pray today. Father, I pray that you bless all of our people, all of our friends. I pray that when they see this video, whatever day it goes up, that you would fill them with your spirit, that you'd fulfill the promise that on my sons and daughters, on all of our people's spiritual, pour out your spirit. The young men would dream dreams, the old men would see visions, and on the handmaidens you pour out your spirit. And I ask that you bless all of the community, Lord. Fulfill the scripture. The Lord gave the word. Great was the company of those that published it. They will be like fountains dispersed abroad and like rivers of waters in the streets. Let the words that you have put in my mouth not depart out of my mouth, not of the mouth of my seed, nor of the mouth of their seed from this time forth and forevermore. Amen.